Good morning. I am Rica Lazo. Here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. Typhoon Karding leaves at least 9 people dead in the Philippines. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. appoints former Chief Justice Lucas Bersamin as his new executive secretary. And Cuba and Florida bracing for the destructive impact of Hurricane Ian. The death toll from Typhoon Karding rises to 9. The National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council has recorded 2 casualties in Zambales Province, one in Quezon and another in Bataan, on top of the 5 rescuers who died in Bulacan. The NDRRMC also observed significant agricultural losses, while damage to infrastructure was minimal.
Ang agriculture natin ang suffered most from this typhoon. 160 million worth of damage to agriculture has been reported by our department department concerned, and close to 3,780 affected farmers and fisher folks.
11,000 families across Luzon were also forced to evacuate, but many have returned to their homes. The province of Nueva Ecija declares a state of calamity due to widespread destruction caused by Typhoon Karding. Hundreds of families remain in evacuation centers as local authorities continue clearing operations. Classes in all levels remain suspended. The largest damage in the province is in agriculture, with Nueva Ecija serving as the rice granary of Central Luzon.
Malungkot po yan. Dahil sa yuanin, konti na lang. Unabis na marami, kumonte. Mapalit pa po tayo kaysa sa ibang lugar.
Kaya po sana kung sino po yung may mabuting loob, yung sa ating Pangulo, nais ko rin po humingi ng tulong sa kanya, hindi lang po para sa akin, kundi para na rin sa lahat ng nasalanta.
The local government of Polillo Island in Quezon Province mulling to declare a state of calamity in the aftermath of Typhoon Karding. Mayor Angelique Bosque says they are assessing the full extent of the damage left by the storm. So far, there are no reported casualties in the area, but the storm destroyed homes and left massive damage to agriculture. Mayor Bosque also appealing for immediate assistance from the national government.
Bagyo sa LGU po namin, hindi po namin masabi. Ito po ay pang, siguro po pang ilang araw lang dahil madami din po talaga yung affected families dito po sa amin. 5 pa lang po na barangay ang kanila po naibalik ang power. Regarding po dun sa ibang barangay, ongoing po yung clearing and assessment nila dahil meron nga po mga tanga ng puno na sumabit po sa power line. Doon po sa Palay po, sa sakahan po ng Palay, out of 450 plus hectares, nasa 50% na po yung damage crop. Yun sa mga bananas naman po ay 100% po. And then sa fisheries po, medyo malaki din po yung damage.
Karding made landfall over Polillo Island Sunday as a super typhoon. Karding also left thousands of families homeless in the province of Aurora. The municipality of Dingalan says over 6,000 houses were damaged. The provincial government plans to help typhoon survivors through a cash for work program.
Yung mga nasiraan ng bahay ay tatrabahuhin ko nila, ayusin nila yung bahay nila. We will provide materials and then meron pa compensation po dun sa kanila.
Initial damage to agriculture in the province is pegged at 51 million pesos. Local officials say Karding is far worse than Typhoon Ulysses, which also hit the province in 2020. But the town mayor is still grateful that no life was lost.
Dahil taon-taon naman po ay talagang dinadalaw ng bagyo itong aming lugar at isa pong paniniwala na ang pagiging handa talaga pong magiging maganda po ang resulta na maiwasan po ang pagkasawi o pagkawala ng isang buhay.
Overwhelming grief in the Philippine province of Bulacan after 5 rescuers died while trying to get people to safety during the onslaught of Typhoon Carding. This story from Katrina Domingo.
A sense of anguish enveloped the town of San Miguel as cries of grief pierced Camias village, where lifeless bodies of 5 veteran rescuers were found Monday morning. The team from the Provincial Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office was out to look for trapped residents after Typhoon Carding triggered flash floods in various parts of Bulacan. But little did they know that they will be the ones in need of saving.
Nagsira yung truck nila, tapos bumaba na lang, nagbangka na lang sila para makarating dun sa sasagipin nila. Ngayon din ang nangyari nga daw ay may bumulugnos na pader. Parang sa kanila tumama, sa lakas ng current, natangay sila.
The provincial government will be shouldering the funeral and burial or cremation fees for the rescuers who the province now hails as heroes.
Mga anak ko sila, pamilya kami sa Bulacan Rescue, kaya napakasakit, 5. Ang mahalaga, tinaas nila yung bandila ng mga rescuers na hanggang sa huli, willing nilang sacrifice yung mga sarili nila para sa dakilang layunin ng pagbibigay serbisyo sa mamamayan.
Aside from experienced rescuers, Bulacan also lost at least 3 billion pesos to agricultural damage.
Right now, pinapa-assess muna natin sa PDRIMO kung tayo magde-declare ng state of calamity. Ano po sa mga nangyayari ito?
The National Irrigation Authority explains this is due to the overflowing of the Bulo Dam, an open dam that has no retractable doors to control the flow of water. The typhoon also triggered floods in various parts of Pampanga. In the town of Macabebe, about a dozen villages are affected. Flooded schools will have to implement blended learning for their students. In Mabalacat City, electrical sparks from a power line triggered a power outage. The ceiling of the female ward in the municipal infirmary of Candaba collapsed. Affected patients were transferred to other rooms.
Few days po, ayusin na po itong ceiling po ng community hospital.
Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News. Typhoon Carding, with international name Noru, left the Philippine area of responsibility on Monday night. It seemed to be picking up strength as it crosses the South China Sea towards Vietnam. But State Weather Bureau Pagasa says Filipinos can still expect rainy weather today due to the southwest monsoon. It will bring moderate to heavy rains over Palawan and Occidental Mindoro. Meanwhile, light to moderate with the times heavy rains will be experienced over Zambales and Bataan. An environmental group calls on the Philippine government to declare a climate emergency following the onslaught of Typhoon Carding. Action Clima convener Rodney Galicia says, aside from empowering local government units to deal with disasters, a climate emergency declaration puts the Marcos administration in a better position to ask for climate reparations in the upcoming United Nations Climate Change Conference in Egypt.
If we have that institutionalization of climate emergency, and that includes actually loss and damages and nationally determined contribution, then we have that document. If that will be part of the law of the land, then we can lobby. At the level of the United Nations. We'll be able to actually make them accountable, and of course influence them, force them if necessary, in diplomatic terms. No. To actually sit down with us, and instead of us asking for loans, we need to have more grants, and through diplomacy and through, you know, demanding climate justice.
On to the other side of the world, Hurricane Ian is barreling towards Cuba. The Cuban government declared a cyclone alert in 6 of its western provinces as Ian rapidly intensified into a Category 2 storm. Authorities say they are ready to evacuate residents in affected areas. The U.S. National Hurricane Center warned Ian will pass near the Cayman Islands and then over western Cuba late Monday or early Tuesday. Florida also hunkering down ahead of the possible onslaught of Ian. State Governor Ron DeSantis has declared a state of emergency in all 67 counties, with a storm expected to make landfall on Wednesday or Thursday. Residents are stocking up on food, water, medicine, and fuel. The local government has also activated 7,000 National Guard personnel to help with relief and rescue efforts. NASA is also pressing pause on its rocket launch to the moon due to the hurricane. Back here at home, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has appointed former Chief Justice Lucas Bersamin as his new executive secretary. Bersamin took his oath before Marcos today. The palace says he began his duties immediately by attending the 9th cabinet meeting. Bersamin replaces Marcos's longtime lawyer and spokesman Vic Rodriguez, who resigned this month. Bersamin most recently headed government-owned insurance system GSIS. He was appointed to that post by former President Rodrigo Duterte back in 2020 after he retired as the country's top magistrate. In other news, another grim outlook for the global economy. The Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, or OECD, says global growth is slowing faster than was forecast months ago as energy and inflation woes due to Russia's war risk snowballing into recessions. While global growth is still expected at 3% this year, it is projected to slow to 2.2% in 2023. That's down from a June forecast of a 2.8% expansion. The OECD is particularly pessimistic for Europe, the most directly exposed economy to Russia's war in Ukraine. It also sees the German economy contracting next year due to its dependence on Russian gas.
Before the war, the economy, the world economy was recovering from COVID. In fact, some economies were recovering fairly well. Inflation was starting to creep up, but it was not so dramatic. So we are paying a very hefty price because, as a consequence of all this, we are having an inflation around the world, in many countries of the world, that we haven't seen for a long time. And central banks now have been able to start acting so that to circumvent this problem. And on the other hand, we also have a significant slowdown of the economy. So it's a very hefty price of the war.
Though far less dependent on imported energy than Europe, the U.S. was seen skidding into a downturn as the Federal Reserve jacks up interest rates to get a handle on inflation. Meanwhile, the OECD says China's strict COVID measures may limit its economic growth to only 3.2% this year. The International Monetary Fund slashing its growth forecast for the Philippines. It sees the local economy growing 6.5% this year. That's weaker than the IMF's previous 6.7% forecast, but still within the government's growth target of 6.5 to 7.5%. A further slowdown is seen in 2023, with growth hitting just 5%. The IMF says slower growth in the country's major trade partners, namely China and the U.S., will affect the Philippines this year.
The economy has been able to recover swiftly and remains fundamentally sound. But the world has been dealt with a 1-2 punch. The pandemic is behind us, but we are now confronted with a gloomier and more uncertain global economy. As President Marcos Jr.'s new administration takes the helm, it will face three important challenges. The first is striking the right policy mix to put the recovery on a firmer footing. Second, building fiscal buffers against downside risks. And third, raising long-term growth and the standard of living for all Filipinos.
Meanwhile, the slowdown next year is attributed to the effects of the Philippine Central Bank's monetary policy tightening to fight elevated inflation. The IMF sees the consumer price index in the country hitting 5.3% this year before declining modestly in 2023.
BSP has taken prompt action to tackle inflation. Continued near-term tightening of monetary policy is appropriate to keep inflation expectations anchored and reduce headline inflation securely within the BSP's target range of 2 to 4%. Clear communication about inflation and BSP's forward-looking policy intentions can help reduce uncertainty and improve policy transmission.
We're taking a quick break. Still to come, tight security in place all over Tokyo ahead of the controversial state funeral for former Prime Minister Abe Shinzo. That's next on The Rundown. Stay tuned. Welcome back. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has certified as urgent the proposed spending bill for 2023. The certification was issued on September 16, stating the necessity of the budget's timely passage to maintain continuous government operations, strengthen efforts to respond more effectively to the COVID pandemic, and support initiatives towards national economic recovery. It was received by House Speaker Martin Romualdez on Monday. Romualdez assures the chief executive House lawmakers are on track to approve the general appropriations bill by Wednesday. He says because it was certified as urgent by the president, the bill can now be approved on second and third reading on the same day. Meanwhile, House Ways and Means Chairperson Joey Salceda defends the 588 billion peso unprogrammed funds in the 2023 national budget. The lawmaker says the unprogrammed funds are meant as a conservative measure, wherein part of the national budget will remain on standby. Salceda says there are two ways the unprogrammed funds can be activated.
So, ito pong mga nasa unprogrammed, nare-release po to two ways. One, halimbawa may utang tayo sa ADB, pag na-release yung sa ADB, magkakaroon tayo ng notice of loan proceeds, kukunin po yun dun sa unprogrammed. Excess revenues na hiwala ko sa forecast can also trigger the release. Halimbawa, mabenta natin ang PAGCOR na talaga may decision na po since 2017 to sell PAGCOR for 250 billion. So paano mo gagastusin yun? So yun yung 250 billion na yun, pwede po yun ang mag-trigger nung 588 billion na unprogrammed budget.
The budget department earlier said the funds can be used for emergency situations. Of the 588 billion pesos, 150 billion is allocated for infrastructure projects and social programs. The Philippine Justice Department orders the closure of 175 Philippine offshore gaming operators, or POGOs. Their licenses have been canceled due to alleged criminal activities. Some 280 Chinese nationals who work for the POGOs are now under custody. Justice officials say more than 40,000 Chinese nationals working in the POGO industry are set to be deported in batches. The Justice Department is coordinating with the Chinese embassy to begin the deportation process in October. The House of Representatives approves the ease of paying taxes bill on final reading. 250 lawmakers voted in favor of the measure, which would institutionalize simplified tax returns and processes for smaller taxpayers for ease of compliance to tax rules and regulations. It introduces a medium taxpayer classification and a corresponding Bureau of Internal Revenue special unit. It also enhances the portability of tax transactions by removing venue restrictions in the filing of returns and payment of taxes. House Ways and Means Committee Chair Joey Salceda sees the bill yielding an estimated 73.1 billion pesos in additional revenues over a period of 5 years. That, as he notes, a more efficient tax administration results in improved ease of doing business. A warning from North Korea, as South Korea and the U.S. begin their first joint naval exercise in 5 years. Pyongyang's ambassador to the United Nations called the drills a dangerous act that could bring the Korean Peninsula to the brink of war. The joint drills come a day after nuclear-armed North Korea conducted another ballistic missile launch, the latest in its record-breaking blitz of weapons tests this year. Earlier this month, the North revised its nuclear weapons law, allowing it to carry out a preventive nuclear strike immediately to destroy what it called hostile forces. Over in Japan, security forces on high alert ahead of the controversial state funeral of slain former Prime Minister Abe Shinzo today, Tuesday. Thousands of police officers have been deployed across Tokyo amid public anger over the use of public funds for the $11 million event. Thousands have been holding protests in the capital since last week, demanding the state funeral be called off. The ceremony will begin at 2 in the afternoon Tokyo time. Dozens of foreign dignitaries are expected to attend. For the Philippines, it will be Vice President Sara Duterte, who earlier said she is bringing condolence letters from her father, former President Rodrigo Duterte, and from President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. A school shooting rocks Russia with 13 people dead, including 7 children. 14 other minors and 7 adults were also wounded. Authorities say the gunman, who was said to be wearing clothes with Nazi symbols, committed suicide. Russian President Vladimir Putin has denounced the shooting, describing it as an inhuman terrorist attack. Still in Russia, President Putin has granted Russian citizenship to U.S. whistleblower Edward Snowden. This development comes at a time when relations between Washington and Moscow are at historic lows over the war in Ukraine. The former American intelligence contractor has been living in exile in Russia since 2013 after leaking files that revealed the U.S. government was spying on its citizens. For years, U.S. authorities have wanted him returned to America to face a criminal trial on espionage charges. Snowden's lawyer says his spouse would also now apply for Russian citizenship, while their daughter already has a Russian passport, having been born in the country. Congratulatory messages pour in for Giorgia Meloni, who is on course to become Italy's first ever female prime minister. British Prime Minister Liz Truss congratulated Meloni on the victory of her party, the far-right Brothers of Italy. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken, meanwhile, says America is eager to work with Italy's new government. The win of the Brothers of Italy party marks a seismic change in Italy, as Meloni is expected to lead the most right-wing government in the country since World War II. Meloni, a former teen activist who has railed against the European Union, vowed to govern for all Italians in her first public statement since Sunday's elections. And that's the rundown. I am Rika Lazo. We'll be back with more news at 11. Keep it here on ANC.